But you know, in Ghana, no club can pay a player salary more than 1,000 or more than $2,000.
Interesting.
Yeah, because you can see some of the players are suffering. Hello there, welcome to another exciting edition of The Untold Stories. And it's always been great coming your way with stories that has never been told by some of these legends or sports personalities as they share with us their life stories. It's another great day, and today we are here with another legend, and he will be sharing his story with us. Stories that has never, ever been told by these legends of our game. With us is former coach, player, and he's seen it all when it comes to the round ladder, and I'm talking about football. Coach Michael Osei is our guest on the show today. Coach, welcome.
Thank you. Yeah. How are you?
I'm doing great. I hope everything is fine.
Yeah, we are managing because this pandemic season is very tough for everybody. So we need to manage it and then see how our God will do it for us.
We just hope and pray.
Yeah.
Let's get a bit into your early stages or your life when you started. For some of us, we are privileged too, because I also come from the same place that you grew up. Whenever that name is mentioned, there is this perception that nothing good comes out from that place. But growing up, how do you guys manage to sail through, to go all the way to play for Kotoko? Where did it start for you before even playing for Kotoko?
Actually, that the area that you are talking about is a football area, because Kumasi Asante Kotoko was very close to that area, which is Menshia Palace, Otumfuo's area. And then we were living in Aswasi. Aswasi is a place, we are in the middle of between Abuabu and then Menshia. And then that area is a football area. We were always playing football in the streets, and then a lot of pitches around, school pitches around that area. So when we were growing up, we saw top stars like Chen Chen Hini, Abdul Razak, and so on, George Kennedy's, and so on. So we were eager to be one day to play for Kumasi Asante Kotoko. So for me, my dreams came true, and then I was once a Kotoko player, and then later I became a coach too.
So football has always been something you were looking forward to do. It has always been your passion.
Yeah, because when I was a little boy, when we were playing football in the streets or in the school park, people were calling me Pele, Pele, Pele. So I was also it motivates me, and then I was dreaming that one day I'll be a footballer.
The next Pele.
And then that area was a football area, like I was saying. We always saw football. We always hear some stars' names, and then I thought one day I'll also become one of the top players
top
in the
players.
Area. Yeah.
We know Asawasi to be an area that, I mean, most of the kids there are very stubborn, radical, and all that. Growing up in such a community, how difficult was it? Were you that kind of a stubborn type, and I want to play football and nothing else, not even education? How was the experience like?
Actually, my father was very, very tough, because he was very restricted man, because he doesn't give us so many chances to always playing only. He was trying to push us in the education area also.
Okay.
So for me, I was very a quiet guy, and that area also was sorry to say, Hausa people is also around the area, that area. Then if you are not tough, you can't
live in the area. Exactly. Survival of the fittest.
Yes. So it also helps us that in growing up, I mean, to play football, you have to be very tough. Mm. You have to be aggressive too, because in football, I mean, if you are not tough,
you can't succeed.
Yeah, you can't succeed.
So which school did you attend in?
I attend Kenyanko LA.
Okay.
And then later I moved to Asimboys in Asafu area. And then after Asimboys, I went to technical school,
okay.
KTI, okay. Kumasi Technical Institute. And then my eyes was always in the football area.
But what were your parents, I mean, what did they want you to do? Because taking you to KTI and all that, it means they wanted you to become something that was not football.
Actually, they saw that I have the talent. Mm. I have the talent. So people were always talking to my father, this your son,
he's good.
So allow him to play football.
Mm.
And then also some of the people like Sunny Dendem, the Anochi Stars owner, the coach, and then the director of the club. Normally, I started playing for King Faisal Coast, and then later Mr. Sunny Dendem came and took us from, we were three players from that area,
okay.
And then he took us to Anochi Stars because he was that time. Kotoko, young Kotoko, he was part of the young Kotoko coast team, but later he decided to go and, I mean, build his own team. Yeah, so we are the people we started with that Anochi Stars. I was with Yausu, the former player of Ash Gold, and then Stanley Abra was also among Stanley Abra, the former Kotoko player. Yeah. So. We started that project for Anochi Stars.
So, I mean, at what point did your breakthrough come in? Because as a child, you were always dreaming to play for Kotoko.
Yeah.
That was your biggest dream.
Yeah.
I mean, if you play for him, means you've made it in your career.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah.
So, yeah. At what point did that breakthrough come?
Yeah, I think all started when I went to after Anochi Stars, after Coast, and then I got the opportunity to play for New Plan Stars.
Okay.
And then sometimes we play friendly matches against Kumasi Asante Kotoko, and then I was a very young player, but because when you saw me play, you'll be happy. I mean, there's such a young talented, and then he was playing among the older people.
Mm.
And then I think after I get the opportunity to play for New Plan Stars, we played the FA Cup against Oko United in FA Cup. And then immediately after the game, Coach Adi was the coach from the Oko United.
Mm.
Immediately after the game, he told my people, or my chairmen and my coaches, that this boy, I like him to come and play for Oko United.
Okay.
That's where the breakthrough started. Yeah, so I got the opportunity to go to Oko United.
Find your first Premier League.
Exactly.
Contract.
Yes, and then I was happy because I met a lot of quality players. People like Aladji Bellows, Ibrahim Meriga, Joe Champong, Abadi Da Costa, a lot of quality players.
Mm.
That was the days of Oko United, Asasiaba.
Mm.
Yeah, they were having a lot of quality players, especially in the midfield. So I went there, and then I played very well in that two seasons I played for Oko United. And then, Kotoko came for me. I played very well in the Oko United, and then like I was saying, I was also a national player. That time I started playing for under 17 before I get an opportunity to play for the Satellite 2. And then that time I was one of the top stars ending in 80s. These are the time we have a lot of quality players in the system, because there was no players exodus that time. You know, all the players are always in the system, so it's always very difficult to break through.
Mm.
Yeah, and then one day, after I played two seasons, and then I came back to Kumasi for vacation or for holidays, and then one day I was at home, and then I heard someone is looking for me, and then when I came outside from the room from my our house, I saw Coach Ibrahim Sunday.
Mm.
Oh, then I was shocked, and he told me, Michael, how are you? And I said, oh, Coach, I'm doing well. And then he said, okay, come and let's go, and then let's talk something. And then when we were going, he told me he has monitored me for so long, so he wants me to come and play for Kumasi Asante Kotoko.
Mm.
It was that time also, Ash Gold has come for me.
Mm.
for my service.
Mm.
And then they have already paid me some of the
wow.
money they wanted to pay. So when Coach Ibrahim Sunday came for me, and then he said, Coach Michael, I want you to come and play for Kumasi Asante Kotoko for the coming season. And then I couldn't say anything, because it was my dream that
mm.
I will one day play for Kumasi.
So apart from it being your money, they were offering bigger than that of Ashgold.
Actually, the Ashgold, I think the Ashgold money was bigger, but they told me that they will pay that amount for me.
How much was Ashgold?
I think it was if it this time.
Mm.
I think it will be 60,000.
So 60,000 Ghana.
Yeah, if it was this.
So 600 million old currency.
Yeah,
at that time.
Yeah.
And Kotoko was willing to pay you that.
Yeah,
amount.
Yeah, they wanted to pay. Maybe I got more, because some of the management members, those board members, some of them,
they dashed me
secretly, you know.
Mm.
So,
if Michael has a question to you, but before that, let me chip this in quickly.
Yeah.
You said that at that time there was no player exodus.
Mm-hmm.
So all the quality players were still in the system.
In the system, exactly.
And it was even very difficult for you to break into a team.
Yeah, if you don't have the quality. Yeah.
Now you are still now a coach.
Yeah.
What do you think we are not doing right currently?
The problem is
because we would say that now football has changed, it's money, but mm-hmm. then it was also money. You guys were feeding, that was your profession then.
You know, that time it was different. If you sign a contract, and then they give you that money.
Mm-hmm.
If you are extending it, you don't get another money.
Okay.
Yeah, the money that you get in the beginning,
that's the same money.
Yeah, that's
okay.
All. You
okay.
don't get more. If you play 20 years, 30 years in that club.
It was
yeah.
just your salary that would
you
are going
exactly,
to
pay. Exactly, yeah. So, it was very interesting. I mean,
but what do you think is wrong now?
Oh, the wrong now is all about financial. You understand?
You think you don't have the money?
No, you don't have the money to give to them players.
But football is business now, and you can make money out of it. Don't you think maybe we are not really fine tuning our mind to the business aspect of football?
But you know, in Ghana, no club can pay a player salary more than 1,000 or more than 2,000. Dollars.
Interesting.
Yeah, because you can see some of the players are suffering, and then if you end your career in Ghana here, I don't think you can survive. If you don't take it, you become a beggar.
So it's always advisable to leave.
Exactly. From my opinion, I think if you're able to do things better, I mean, you get sponsors, and then you can pay the players some amount, I think the players as adults will be limited.
Mm.
Yeah, will be limited. Yeah.
Well, Coach, playing for Kotoko, I mean, snubbing Ashko,
yeah.
playing for your dream club, Asante
yeah.
Kotoko,
yeah.
and the euphoria, because all along you were hoping to play for
yeah,
Kotoko, Asawasi
yeah.
boy,
yeah.
who has played for now Kotoko.
Yeah.
how was the feeling like?
So it was great because, like I was saying, it was my dream to play for Kumasi Asante Kotoko because the team was very close to my area. It was just a stone throw to reach there to where they are training distance. And then I was so happy to become a Kotoko player because that time I was already a national player because I have played the Starlights, I have played the Satellite, and then I was about to graduate to the senior national team. And then immediately I came to Kotoko, I also get a call from the senior national team because I was progressing every year. I was doing very, very well because my career in local scene, I would say it was amazing.
You are still live on the Untold Stories, and with us here is former Asante Kotoko coach, player, and national team star Michael Osei. And whenever the name is mentioned, I mean, he is one of the few Ghanaians and African players to have played in the German Bundesliga when the German league was very, very exciting. We will go there, but let's wrap up with Kumasi Asante Kotoko. So, how many seasons did you play for Kotoko?
Actually, Kumasi Asante Kotoko, I couldn't play too long because I got the opportunity to go to Europe.
Okay.
Because when I came to Kumasi Asante Kotoko, our era, we did very well because I came and met a place like Frimpong Manson, the Kwesi Appiah, the national ex-national team coach, Emmanuel Ampia, Stanley Abra, Joe Debras, Thomas Boaches. Because these are the players I was playing with them already in the national team. So when I came to the team, I fitted into the team so quickly. Yeah, so I played very well in Kumasi Asante Kotoko.
So how many years did you play in Kotoko?
2 years, two seasons.
How much did you make in Kotoko?
How much
I
was no, you know, those days, like I was saying, after my contract, my first contract, I get that money. I couldn't get any money anymore unless all the salaries and then and the winning bonuses and then, because that time the economy wasn't so
good.
Yeah,
as of now.
Yeah, it wasn't like today, you know. Things was a little bit softer than this
so time. You know, Kotoko fans, they are very generous. Mm-hmm. I mean, what was the craziest thing that Kotoko fan did for you?
Oh, a lot, because especially when you play a game in Accra here, and then after the game we are about 3-4 players, myself, Joe Debra, Thomas Boachi, and so on. We will not go with the team to Kumasi. We will stay Accra here, then we move around to Kantamanto, and then people will give us a lot of money. It was amazing.
Amazing.
Yeah.
And what was your best moment at Kotoko? Your best moment.
My best moment.
Kotoko.
Yeah, my best moment was when we won against Accra House of Folk in the President Cup. Yeah, we played in Accra here. So after the game, we got a lot of gifts. Like I was saying, in our era, we did a lot for Kumasi Asante Kotoko. I mean, we won the FA Cup, we won the President Cup, we won the league.
You guys were on top.
Yeah, we were on top. But that time, has also have a very good players. Players like Joe Ados and Emmanuel Amas, Shamokwe, Abladi Kuma. It was very challenging, very, very challenging. But those days it was always, when you are playing against House of Folk, it's Joe Debla against Shamokwe, then Mike Loze against Abladi Kuma. Yeah, it was amazing. We were having a quality players. I mean, we were really enjoying the game.
Well, coach, briefly, Kumasi Asante Kotoko, Michael Osei as a player, Michael Osei as a coach. Did you enjoy your time as a coach at Kotoko, or you feel that there was more you could have done if given the chance?
Actually, if I've been given a chance, I could have done better, but you never know. That's life, you know. So I will not put a blame too much to people, you understand. So I took it as a one of the challenges in life, because when I became a head coach or acting head coach, I think after six matches, Duncan was my head coach. I was assisting him, and then he went when we were playing only six matches in 2016, 2017 league. Then I played all the matches. When he was leaving the club, I think we were in the 15th position.
Yeah.
So when we finished playing the league, I knew I came to four position or something.
So you did an incredible
job. Yeah, I think I did my best. Yeah, not only me, I mean the players also did their best.
So on a scale from 1 to 10, how would you rate yourself at Kotoko as a coach when you're a coach there? Your performance, how would you rate it?
Actually,
from 1 to 10.
1 to 10.
Just give me a figure.
How much will you give me?
Oh, but you're rating yourself.
how can I rate myself?
You know the work you did there.
Actually.
On a percentage wise.
Okay, percentage wise. Let I will give myself
80%.
Yeah.
Wow.
Because as that time as a young coach, and then such a pressure, and then I was able to
manage it.
One day I was there, and then. Our operation manager, Mr. George Kennedy, and then he told me, Michael, you have done so well. The way you have managed the dressing room, I didn't believe that you could do that. So that also motivated me, and then I think I was able to do my best. And then, but when the new management came, and then. There was a lot of problems which I don't want to say it, because it's a past now.
Mm.
It's a past now. So I move on my life, and then I got the opportunity to come to because when I was there, I was one of the coaches. I won trophies because I was able to win the President Cup. Because President Cup, I won it as a player, and then as a coach.
Okay.
And then I was able, when I was with Didi Dramani too, Didi went to Blasters to join the team in 2014. I won the FA Cup alone when he was not around. And then I also won G6 in second D.
So I mean, you had incredible time there.
Yeah.
But coach, I mean, let's delve away a little bit from the coaching aspect.
Yeah.
Now from Kotoko.
Yeah. Then from Kotoko, I moved to
Germany.
No. From Kotoko, I moved to Liberty Professionals. Okay. You mean in my coaching?
No, in your playing
career. In my playing career,
From Kotoko, you got a chance to travel. As Michael stated earlier.
Yeah, I got the opportunity to go to Austria, and then I started in Austria. And then later on, I got the opportunity to come to Germany, which I will say big thank you to Tony Yeboah. Because he was that time a hero in Frankfurt team, so he spoke to the coach that his cousin is in Austria. He's a very young, talented footballer, so he wants him to come and try if he can make it. And then when I came to Frankfurt, after 2-3 training sessions, the coach told me, "Oh, your brother is a very fine player. He had a perspective, and then we can keep him. But the problem is we have." A lot of foreigners, but only three players can play in the game. So we can keep him here, and then he can stay to the senior side, but he will play always in the second team or the junior side. So I started from there, but very unfortunate, very very unfortunate. This is a time when I remember that time. I feel so sad in my football career, because I got a very serious injury which kept me home for almost more than a year I couldn't play. So that's why I couldn't internationally, couldn't
excel.
Exactly excel, because I was one of the midfielders I was one of the central midfielders in Ghana here or in Africa here. Because when I was playing in the local system, every club I play, I was a regular player. And then in the national team too, when I was playing Starlet, I was regular player. When I was playing the Satellite, I was one of the best. And then Blasters too, I was one of the best, because when Booker Caesar came to Ghana, when we were playing Senegal 92 qualified, I was one of the best in the team. I normally play with Maestro Abedipele in the midfield. So when I went to Germany, and then things went
bad,
sometimes I feel very sad.
Did you ever regret
leaving Austria for Germany?
No, because that was my career, because I wanted to
move up.
I wanted to move up, and then such opportunity came to come to play a team like Frankfurt. And try Frankfurt. It's amazing, you know. It's a great. So I will never regret, but. It's a part of the game. It's a part of the game. The injury is part of the game. But at that time, after the injury, I tried a lot to push up, because I was very young. I was that time 23, 22 years.
When you went to Frankfurt, which year was that?
It was 93.
Okay.
Yeah, from us, because I went to Austria 91, and then I moved.
So you spent 2 years in Austria, and then you moved to Frankfurt. So you played how many years with them in the Indian season? Was it early stages?
My second season, which I was about to hit the highest distance, you know. So we were playing last but one.
Game.
Which is the junior side, the second team game, and then I get that serious
injury.
But after the injury, when I came back, I was able to play it, but it wasn't so. But always problem with the knee, because I get the opportunity also. I get the offer to go to Venezuela to play. FC Caracas, and then they were already qualified for.
But you couldn't go.
Yeah, I went. I went and played after the injury, and then I played their Champions League, Copa Libertadores. I played there for 6 months, and then I came back, and then I went to Mainz 05. That's where I played with the Liverpool coach Jürgen Klopp. We played together in Mainz 05. That time it was. Second division. Still having problems with the knee, which later on the doctors advised me to stop playing the professional football, because the training is too intensive for
so
me.
So it wasn't your plan to quit?
No, it wasn't my plan to quit.
And this was at what age did you decide to quit?
I was that time 25, 26.
You're still young.
Yeah, I was very young, so I normally play the amateur league, which we don't train a lot. We train maybe 2-3 times in the week, and then we played a game. So that was my story. That's why I couldn't share in the international.
That's a very sad story. Yeah. But what was the highest money that you got in your career when you went international?
I couldn't get any money, because I couldn't play to the level that I can get that highest money. But
so you didn't make a lot in football then?
Actually football, no, not too much, but the little that I got, I managed to do something, because it was also a very sad case when I came to Ghana. And then when I was in Kotoko, I lost my house, got burned. Yeah, the complete house.
Wow.
Yeah, for me, I'm still my close. Once I have life. In coaching, I think I've done a lot. That because I started my coaching in Germany. When one of my senior coaches, he coached me in Frankfurt when I was playing the second team. And then one day he called me and said, "Yeah, Mike, I saw you. You are one of the African players. You are very disciplined, and you have a lot in your mind.
So you wanted you to go into coaching.
Into coaching. Yeah.
So he motivated you to
exactly,
okay.
exactly. And then I joined him when he was a technical director in one of the second division clubs. So he put me onto the second team, the under 23 team. And then I was assistant coach. And then immediately we won the league in that under 23 team. Mm. And then we moved to another club. And then we also won the league twice on the row. And then later I decided, and then I did some of my coaching courses. And then later I decided, no. In Europe, it will be very difficult as a black man to
break into
that coaching.
But you could have taken that challenge to work hard and break into it.
I thought also when I come to my country, I mean, I can use that experience to do something.
But do you think you've made the best decision to come to your country?
Actually, it wasn't bad decision.
It wasn't bad decision.
Yeah. For me, I believe it wasn't bad decision. But I will not say I will regret it or something like that. But that's life, you know. There are challenges in life. So as a man, you always have to face it. And I mean, try. And
so as a coach and as a player, which of these fields would you say that you see yourself succeeding more?
Actually, I can say I'm still in coaching, you know. But until now, I think I have achieved a lot in the coaching, because when I started in Germany, I won the continuous three trophies in the league. Mm-hmm. And then I came to Ghana. Mm-hmm. I started with New Edibiasi with Abdul Salam. Mm-hmm. And then immediately we won the FA Cup to go to Africa. It mm-hmm. was the first time New Edibiasi was able to qualify such a competition. Mm-hmm. And then when I came to Kumasi Asante Kotoko, I won triple with Didi Dramani. I was also one of the luckiest coaches, because I came and met coaches
the
system already. They have made it. Mm. And then which is Didi Dramani and David Duncan. Mm. So I learned something also from them. So when I was in Kotoko, as a coach, I won a lot of trophies.
But coach, I know this is going to be a very difficult question for you to answer, but honestly, you have played for Kotoko before. You have coached, so you know the system better than some of us.
Yeah.
You sit on radio and speak without knowing what the problem is. Yeah. What is wrong with Asante Kotoko now?
It's a managerial problem.
This is a question is very difficult to answer. Mm. It's very difficult to answer, because Kotoko,
what is Kotoko not doing right?
Betty, this is a very difficult question for me to answer.
okay.
Yeah.
Does Kotoko have the quality player? Do they have quality players?
We always have a quality players,
but
you know, the generation right now is very difficult to keep players. Mm. Yeah, and it's also very good to keep a players, because you need the consistency. Mm. If the consistency is not there, it will be very difficult to break through, because Kotoko have not for past years, Kotoko have not been able to keep players. The one problem is also changing coaches
frequently.
It's also one of the things that's not helping
the team. Think the coaches are not that bad?
No, there are some coaches, they are not bad, and then they will sack them, because when every coach comes, he wants to bring his players.
Is politics killing Kotoko?
No, I will not say it's politics.
Not asking the politics on the
bigger level. Maybe we are not managing things very well.
You mean
for my opinion, exactly.
Not managing it
well. That's my opinion. They are not managing things very well, because their coaches, they sacked them, which wasn't proper. But we all believe that the new board, which our two four have appointed, they will do their best. I mean, because they were behind, they have seen a lot in the inside what the club is doing. So let's wish them very best of luck and then hope that things will be better for them.
Will you be ready to stage a comeback if you are called upon to coach Kotoko again?
That's our job, because that's my job. I'm still coaching. So as for the coaching, you never know whenever you go to a club that let me put it this way. You can never say I will not coach this team in my life, or I will coach this team.
It is your job. Anything
comes, then. So,
but coach, there is one thing that I want to ask. You know, it seems our local players.
Yeah.
I mean, some time ago when you are mentioning coaches, John Fatukwefio, we look at their credentials and what their capabilities.
Yeah.
But it seems you are lacking that kind of coaches currently. What is the problem?
No, I don't think.
Are coaches now not upgrading themselves?
No, because some of our coaches here, they let me put it this way.
Mm.
Yeah, that those days the players are quality.
So they were,
and then they were in the system for very long. So it was easy for the coaches. I mean, to,
well, now we don't have quality players.
We have the quality players, but they don't stay in the system very long.
Mm.
Okay.
Somebody who play one or two seasons, then.
Tanzania,
Sudan,
But that is why you are not getting the best out of our coaches.
Exactly, because you have a very, very good coaches.
The reason why I'm asking this question is now, you know, when we were appointing a coach for the Black Stars, I mean, it was all over. We always found it a problem to appoint local coaches because we think they can't do the job.
Maybe I can even say that we have even good coaches more than before.
Really?
Yeah, because we have coaches who have played the game here.
Mm.
They were in the local system before they went to outside internationally, and then they have come back to the system. So the problem is the consistency in the players here.
Mm.
Because they are not playing too long in the local scene. Because those days, look at Akosi Apia. He played for Kumasi Asante Kotoko for almost 10 years.
But did he succeed as a coach for Blaster?
I think he did his best.
To you, did he succeed?
Yeah, me, for me, I would say he succeeded, because
if I to mark him, what percentage do you give him? As a coach of the Blaster.
Betty, it's normally sometimes it's difficult to give such a mark, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because like I was saying, the players in the system, they don't stay here for long time.
Mm-hmm.
You understand? So sometimes it's very difficult for coaches here to succeed.
Now you were impressed with his work.
Yeah, I was very impressed.
So now, of course, you'll be wrapping up soon. Currently, what are you doing? You know, you are with Star Madrid.
Yeah. I'm still in Star Madrid because I came to this club when I was in Liberty Professionals. After Kumasi Asante Kotoko, I moved to Liberty Professionals, and then as for Liberty, I think I did my best because they were in the relegation zone.
Yeah.
When I went there for second round of 2017-2018 league, and then we were able to survive. I think I did my best. And then when the 2018-2019 season about to start, Men's Gold came for me, which is Nana Pia Mensah.
Yeah.
And then I came to Star Madrid. I was happy to be part of the Star Madrid because I saw that they have a dream.
Mm.
So I was happy to be part of the team. Mm. But unluckily, the main boss got a problem.
Mm.
Yeah. So I decided I will not leave them.
But has that affected the team?
It was affected the team because we financially we were struggling, but I decided I will not leave the club because
they are struggling.
The boss have crisis, and I decided to stay here. I got a lot of offers from the Premier Division clubs, but I decided to stay here.
Really?
Yeah, I get about more than 3-4 teams. They wanted me, but
so when are you staging a comeback to the Premier League?
I've not decided yet.
Okay.
I've not decided yet. Right now, I'm still with the Star Madrid, so. We are praying that things will be better for our boss to come back.
Coach, before we let you go and Michael coming, what advice would you give to the new protocol board team that is formed?
What I would say is, I think they were behind before they came into their position, because I think they have heard a lot, they have seen a lot, so. They shouldn't make mistakes like before. And then
listen to the Kumasi media.
I would not say that. Yeah. Oh, the Kumasi media is doing something which is not helping Kotoko.
I don't know. People are saying.
I'm asking. People are saying. Yeah. And then I also wish them very best of luck, because Kotoko is a big club. I mean, Kotoko is like, when you go to Europe, it's like Manchester United and then Real Madrid and so on. So we wish them all the best of luck. And then also my colleague Masuek Nodu, also I wish him best of the luck to succeed his second term.
Well, Coach, as Betty said, we are wrapping up, but yeah. Do you get in touch with your new club?
Actually, it's been a very long time. Because since he went to
Liverpool,
I think I've not heard from him.
Okay.
But when he was in Germany coaching Mainz and then Dortmund, when I go for attachment in Europe, I always get in touch with him. So he's also one of the best coaches in the world right now, because he's doing a very fantastic job. One thing I would say is when we were playing our playing days, we were having one of our coach, the coach that was coaching us that year, he was one of the coach we all admire him. So you can see that a lot of Mainz players are now coaches.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not surprised that Eugen is doing so well, because Eugen was also a player. When he was playing, he was someone who always tried to motivate players if things is not going well in the game.
Mm-hmm.
So I wasn't surprised that he's doing such a fantastic job in Liverpool.
Would you welcome a move from him for attachment at Liverpool?
Yes. Actually, I'll be happy to do that. But it's right now, it's very difficult.
Yeah.
It's very difficult because Liverpool is a club that a lot of pressure on him. You know, a lot of his colleagues want to go for that attachment. But I always wish him all the best of luck. I'm happy for him that he have made such a remarkable decision.
Mm.
So I wish him all the best.
Mm. It's been quite interesting. It's been revealing, but I know our time is up.
Yeah.
But Coach, if you are off the field, off football, what do you do during your leisure time?
Actually, we have an office. So after training, I go to my office, and then I join my general manager, who is.
So it's always work.
Work, work, work.
You don't watch TV, you don't listen to music, you don't do anything.
No, I mostly watch football in the television. Okay. Sometimes I watch cartoons with my little boy, because he always watches cartoons. Yeah, and then it's also.
Yeah, you have just one boy. I saw one little boy. Is he only your son, or you have other kids?
No, I have other kids who they are in Europe right now.
Okay.
Yeah, I have two kids in
Europe.
One boy, one girl, and then I have two in Ghana here, one girl, one boy.
So this brings us to the end of today's edition of the Untold Stories. We were having a conversation with Ghanaian international and currently a coach, Michael Osei. I know the name rings a bell, and he has shared his story. This is the Untold Story. My name is Betty Yorton. I did this with my colleague, Michael Isia Oche, and our guest for today was Michael Osei. The two Michaels sandwiched me today.